Please stand, beloved brethren.
Merciful and loving Father. We are so thankful, our Father, that you bless us to be able to assemble before your holy presence, to offer a worship service unto thy most holy name. We know, our Father, that we are not worthy, but we ask, our Father, that you would cleanse our hearts and our minds of all unrighteousness, so that everything that we do this day will be according to your will and for the glory of the most holy name. We pray, our Father, that you would look in on all of your servants, wherever they may be. Those of your servants that may be ill, we ask you, Father, to please touch them with your healing hand, if it is thy holy will, that they will be healed from their ailments and will be able to continue on fulfilling their obligations and serving and glorifying the most holy name. Many of your servants may have grown weak in faith, and we ask your Father to please strengthen them this morning as they listen to your holy words. We ask our Father that your words will inspire them to be able to go on fulfilling their obligations and serving and glorifying the most holy name. We know, Father, that we can't do anything without you. And we are asking you this morning to please hear the prayers of all of your servants. There are many of your servants that may have not assembled before you in a long time, but they have assembled before you this morning. And we ask you, Father, to please be merciful unto your children. Grant them your blessing. Grant them your healing power. We ask you, Father, to inspire their hearts and soul that they may be able to continue on fulfilling their obligations and serving and glorifying the most holy name. Help us all, our Father, to be able to avoid the many pitfalls of life. And as we listen to your holy words this morning, we ask you, Father, let it sink deep within our hearts so that we will be strengthened to continue on serving you until the end of our life. We pray, our Father, that you would bless your Son whom you sent to teach your words this morning. Guide him with your Holy Spirit so that he may be able to teach your word with clarity, so that everyone that is listening will be able to understand your truth and will be inspired to go on to serve and to glorify thy most holy name. Our Lord Jesus Christ, we call on you because we know that you was obedient to the Father. You died that we might have a right to everlasting life. And we pray, our Father, that you would, our Lord, that you would please continue to intercede to the Father for us, asking the Father to hear our prayers and forgive our sins so that we can continue to serve you and our Father until the end of our life. Our Father in heaven, we return to you in prayer. Just be with us this morning. Send your Holy Spirit to touch each one of us as we listen to your holy words. And we pray, our Lord, Father, that you would strengthen us all so that we may be able to endure any hardships that we encounter in this life. and we'll be able to go on to serve you until the end of our life. We truly believe that you will be with us throughout our worship service, because we ask everything in the name of thy Son, Jesus. Amen.
Good day to all brothers and sisters throughout the world, to those who are tuned in to our worship service today. This lesson was made by Brother Eduardo V. Manalo when Brother Iranio G. Manalo was still alive. Let us reflect on this lesson and what they made, and let's see if all of us are able to cope up to what this lesson have to say of those who say that they are true servants of the Lord Almighty God. The title of the lesson is How to Identify God's Servants Today. We must understand that the lesson that was just posted, that was a lesson last week. That's why I had to make mention how to identify God's servants today. So let us investigate this claim, brothers and sisters, of those who so-called say that they are God's servant. And let us see if we are able to cope up to the understanding of what the Bible teaches us in how we can prove that we are truly God's servants. It's easy to say that we are servants of God, but proving it is a different thing. Now, if one is able to claim that they are servants of God, they must prove it through biblical teachings, and not only that, but through the practices that the Bible teaches us of how we can remain as God's servants. So, how can we identify God's true servants today? Let us start our studies in the book of Psalms, the chapter 79, verse 13. Then we, your people, the sheep of your flock, will thank you forever and praise you for all time to come. How can we identify the true servants of the Lord Almighty God? The Bible states the sheep of your flock. So it's referring to God's people. So they are considered as God's people. What does the Bible teach us in what we should do? If we are considered as God's people, we will thank you forever and praise you for all time to come. So whether the time is when we are distressed, or whether we are happy, or whether we are in abundance, or whether we are in poverty, or whatever the situation of life is, as true people of God, we continue to praise our God through means of worship service like this, throughout the week of our meeting together, daily prayers, and the Bible studies, through prayers and singing of psalms of praises, all these are one way to praise the Lord Almighty God. So how does God refer to these people that belongs to him? And in other words, how is it that those people who are considered as God's people refer to God? Ezekiel 34, 31. Let's read. You are my flock, the flock of my pasture. You are men, and I am your God, says the Lord God. So what does God have to say to those people that he recognizes as his? He mentions in the Bible, you are man and I am your God, says the Lord. On the other hand, what is it that one can say if he belongs to the Lord Almighty God, that God is their God? Is that very important, brothers and sisters, to know that God is truly our God? Because many might say that they know God, but in reality, they don't even know the true God. Well, to know God, 1 John 2:3 is to obey God. To love God is to obey God, 1 John 5:3. So in reality, one should know how he is to follow God in order to remain as God's people. This way you show that you truly love God. Because if you only utter that, you say you know God, you love God, but you don't obey God, brothers and sisters, that is something that other people are doing in this world. They only have faith, but they don't have works. And the Bible makes mention in James 2, 14, 17, faith without works is dead. Hence, it cannot save us. So let us make sure, brothers and sisters, if we are people of God, we are amongst those who are able to follow the condition that God sets forth for us in order for us to remain as God's people. So what is this one thing that one should do in order to be sure that he is really amongst those who say that they are recognized by our God? Because if you say that you just know God, but you're not really recognized by God, then it's a one-way street. It must be a two-way street, right? So let's read in Galatians 4:9 of the today's English version of the Holy Scriptures. This is what the Bible have to teach us in knowing if we really belong to God. 4:9, I will read. But now that you know God, or I should say, now that God knows you, how is it that you want to turn back to those weak and pitiful ruling spirits? Why do you want to become their slaves all over again? You see, according to the teachings of the Holy Scriptures, what characterizes God's servants according to the Bible? The Bible says, Apostle Paul says, but now that you know God, we already explained a while ago how to really know God, correct? And the Bible says, or I should say, now that God knows you. So really, the one that should also know us is God himself. So what is it that God expects from those people that he recognizes or that belongs to him? Well, they do not turn back or go back to those weak and pitiful ruling spirits. They do not want to become slaves all over again of a sinful way of life. Is that not but just right, brothers and sisters, to understand that an individual who have received a grace like this, belonging to God, being recognized by God, and you recognize him as your God, isn't it only but just and fair to say that you live in accordance to what God expects, so that that two-way street of you knowing God and God knowing you will be intact or will remain? That's so important. Now, others might say, but I know already our Lord Jesus Christ. There's nothing wrong with that. To know God, we already know that the Father is the one true God, and to obey him. How about our Lord Jesus Christ? How is it that one can say that he truly knows the Lord Jesus Christ? 10:27 of the book of John. Let's read. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. We already know that the sheep refers to God's people, as what we have already studied a while ago in the verses that were before this. But the question is this: how is it that they are identified? Those who truly belong to the Lord God, they also follow our Lord Jesus Christ. Others might say, what is these things that we should do in order to follow our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we can become as those sheep that belongs to God, that follows our Lord Jesus Christ? Let's proceed reading in John 10:7-9. Then Jesus said to them again, most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. According to what we have just read, brothers and sisters, what is this that our Lord Jesus Christ wants people to do in order for them to be sheep or to belong to God's nation? Hence, they are recognized by the Lord Almighty God. And not only that, but they recognize God himself and they follow Christ. They enter in our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me ask you this question. Where is our Lord Jesus Christ now, brothers and sisters? Where? He's in our midst, right? Because where two or three are gathered, there am I in their midst. That's Matthew 18:20. Physically, where is he now, brothers and sisters? Colossians 3:1-2. He's seated on the right hand of God. Where are you now, brothers and sisters? Where? Some are in Canada, California. Let's just make it all say we are here on Earth. What did you say? You're in Mars? No, see? You're probably getting hungry. You just want to eat that chocolate bar Mars. But no, that is not the place where you are in. You're here on Earth. And if you're here on Earth, how are you expected to follow the Lord Jesus Christ in entering in Christ? Where could you find those who have already entered in Christ? John 10:16, and other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Where could we find those who have entered our Lord Jesus Christ? They're found in the flock, which is the flock being referred to here in this verse in Acts 20:28 of the Lambda translation. Let's read. Take heed therefore to yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Spirit has appointed you overseers to feed the church of Christ, which he has purchased with his blood. What is the name of the church, or which is that flock? It is called the church of Christ. Others might say that we became members of the church of Christ. We followed our Lord Jesus Christ. We heard his voice. But is it enough that an individual just becomes a member of the church of Christ? That is the first step, or one of the first step, in order to be able to be recognized by God and to also follow the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the first step, to follow him, to enter into his church, the church of Christ. Others might be saying, I'm a member of the church of Christ. I'm therefore known by God, and I know God, and therefore I follow our Lord Jesus Christ. Now that you are a member of the church of Christ, the question is this: how is it that you can be recognized if you are truly a member of the church of Christ? What are the characteristics that should be found amongst those who claim to be members of the church of Christ, to say that they follow Christ, to say that they belong to God himself? Let's turn to 2 Corinthians in the chapter 6, 6 through 7. This is what the Apostle Paul renders to us in this verse. I will read to you the answer. By our purity, knowledge, patience, and kindness, we have shown ourselves to be God's servants. Let's stop there. Let us analyze ourselves. As people who claim that we follow the Lord Jesus Christ, that we are members of the true church of Christ, what are some of the things that should be found in us? Purity. How do we live our lives, brothers and sisters, every day of our life? Do we live pure lives before the sight of God and before Christ? Knowledge, patience, and kindness. Are we kind when we don't have mercy towards people that needs mercy? Have you heard of the fire that burned a whole town here in Hawaii? There are so many merciful people. They're not even members of the church of Christ, but they are one in helping their fellow men. You see, kindness is one of the qualifications of being God's servant, but that's not all. You have to follow all the other footsteps or the other instructions given to you, and also have all this that were mentioned. Kindness. We have shown ourselves to be God's servants by the Holy Spirit, by our true love, by our message of truth, and by the power of God. We have righteousness as our weapon, both to attack and to defend ourselves. Brothers and sisters, these are mentioned here in this lesson that was made by Brother Eduardo V. Manalo long ago, when Brother Iranio G. Manalo was still alive. So people who are in the institution could also reflect upon this lesson and see and find out if we remain as God's servants. And because if we remain as God's servants, then we know that we are in the right path of being saved. Because if we're only servants, but we're not true servants of God, there's no assurance of salvation in that path. So, do you know what the Bible also teaches us and how we recognize those who truly belongs to God? Let's read one of the true love that the Bible is mentioning. You see that Bible there, by our true love? How is true love taught to us by the lesson that was made by Brother Eduardo V. Manalo? And to those who also are united with his administration, are we just reading this out because we're just striving to make a point to make them think that they are wrong? No, we are doing this so that we are highlighting all this lesson that was made by them, so that we could all follow what the Bible teaches concerning and how we can remain as true servants of God. Let's read here in the book of 1 John 4:20 to 21. I will read to you here. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. Why is this being read now to us? Because one of the qualifications of showing that we are servants of God in expressing our true love towards God is to love our brothers and sisters. How much more if they are your brothers and sisters in the flesh and you belong to the church of Christ? They are not only your brethren in the faith, but they are your brethren in the flesh. But can one say that he loves God, but he hates his brother and sister? It is a must to love your brother or your sisters or your brethren in order to say that you know God. How does the Bible classify an individual who says that he loves God but hates his brothers and sisters? He's a liar. If he's a liar, he is not a true servant of God. Hence, will he be saved? Who's the father of liars? John 8:44, the devil was a murderer and a liar ever since the beginning of time. And he's the father of it. Now, if your father is the devil, would you be saved, brothers and sisters? He is the one of the first ones to be thrown into the lake of fire, as written in the book of Revelations. So if you're a follower of the enemy of God and you are misled, you won't be saved. That is sad to say. So why is it that we are reaching out through this lesson, through all the brethren who are in the institution and to all those who belong to the administration? Because this lesson was not made by me. It was made by the present executive minister of the institution now, the Church of Christ. But the question is this: if we are not to comply with what the Bible teaches, then we cannot live in that kind of way of life. Why? Because if we do not comply, then we won't be saved. All your efforts, all your sacrifices, all the things that you do for God, but if it's not based upon true love towards your brothers and sisters, then you are a liar. Does it hurt to be called a liar? Does it hurt? You don't have to believe that you're a liar, but through your actions, if you are not following what God wants, and you say you know God, but you don't obey God, 1 John 2:4, you are a liar. So we still have time to repent. We still have time to change. Why don't we just love one another? Why don't we just reconcile? Why don't we just allow that peace and tranquility will be able to reign? But who has the power to do that? Those who are in the leadership of the current institution. May they practice what they preach. May they be able to put this lesson into action so that they would be able to correct the mistakes, and then we would be able to all be led properly, to be recognized as God's people. Not only that, as God's people, we also can follow the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's not only a one-way street. It's not only saying that you know God. It's not only saying that you love God, but God knows you, God loves you, and also Christ knows you as his sheep. So let us be sure that we follow the instructions given out to us so that we could remain as God's people, how else can we further show that we are truly God's servants? As written in 2 Corinthians, the chapter is 6, the verse is 4. Let me read to you here. In 2 Corinthians 6:4. Instead, in everything we do, we show that we are God's servants by patiently enduring troubles, hardships, and difficulties. How else could we show that we are true servants of God? We are willing to endure troubles. There are those, when they start to experience troubles or hardships, difficulties such as persecution, oppression, they don't want to follow anymore. They will rather go the different route in order to escape that kind of trial in their life. And so they stop following our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. You think that is one way of showing that we are true servants of our Lord Almighty God? True servants of the Lord Almighty God patiently endure troubles, hardships, and difficulties. And that's the reason why we were willing to go through all these sufferings, persecutions, not because we wanted to be different by our other brethren, but because we wanted to show to our God and to the Lord Jesus Christ that we are willing to follow, come what may, even if we have to lose everything, just to follow our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Why is it that is our stand? Let's read in 2 Corinthians 4:16 to 17. I read, "For this reason, we never become discouraged. Even though our physical being is gradually decaying, yet our spiritual being is renewed day after day. And this small and temporary trouble we suffer will bring us a tremendous and eternal glory, much greater than the trouble. For we fix our attention not on the things that are seen, but on the things that are unseen. What can be seen lasts only for a time, but what cannot be seen lasts forever." Why is it that we are willing to go through all these hardships and troubles just to prove that we are true servants of the Lord Almighty God? Because we know that these troubles that we go through are only temporary. And even if you add all these sorrows and problems in this life all together, if you were to compare it to the tremendous glory that is to be given to you on the day of judgment, it cannot be compared. Why is it that it cannot be compared? Because what you will be given is everlasting life. What will you be given is eternal life. What will you do then? You'll spend your eternity with God and with the Lord Jesus Christ and all those who have proven their loyalty and faithfulness to God and to our Lord Jesus Christ through obedience of the teachings that are taught to them. Because of that, they know that they have to endure. They know that even if they will be cast away or be even put in prison or even be rejected by all the other brethren, they hold tight to what the Bible teaches, because all that they would want is that they would spend their eternity with our God and with the Lord Jesus Christ on the day of judgment. So why should we endure? Be patient and not be discouraged even during a calamitous time or during these calamities. What is it that we can expect from the Lord Almighty God when we are in danger, or when we have needs, when we are amongst those who have so much other problems one after another? Why is it that we still remain firm in our love, in our obedience to our God, even if the burden gets heavy, even if there are problems so many? Why is it that we remain diligent in obedience to our God? What can we expect from our God if we show our loyalty to him, even in times that when we are in need in life? Let's turn to 2 Chronicles, the chapters 20, the verses 9, that if any disaster struck them to punish them, a war, an epidemic, or a famine, then they could come and stand in front of this temple where you are worshiped. They could pray to you in their trouble, and you would hear them and rescue them. What is it that we can expect from our God, especially when we feel that there is no one to help us, when we feel that we are in danger, when we feel that there's really no one to turn to, when there are so many other calamities, one after another? Well, the people of God, when they come running to him in near the temple, or when we worship our God like this, when they will pray to our God, what is it that God will do? They would be heard. They would be rescued. How many times have God heard our prayers? How many times did God rescue us? How many times did God give us the solutions to our problems? How many times have God proven over and over that as long as we are faithful to him, as long as we are true to him, as long as that we follow him and the Lord Jesus Christ, during the time when you need to be rescued, he will hear you. He will help you. And so what is it that God expects from his true servants? And this is the reason why he's really willing to save them or give them an answer to their supplications when they are in need. 63:8 of Isaiah, the Lord said, "They are my people. They will not deceive me." And so he saved them. What is God's expectation amongst those who consider themselves as God's servants because they followed and obey him? Come with me in their life. He will not deceive me. Do you think when you already followed the voice, hearing the voice of Christ, of being members of the church of Christ, that is the first part that you should do? God expects you to prove yourself, not to disobey God. God does not want you to deceive him. Could you imagine how is it that you will be able to deceive God? Could you imagine all his investment in giving his only begotten son, and the son giving his own life for the church, and now you turn away from him? Others might say, how is it that I turn away from God? By not means of obeying what God wants you to do for your fellow man, by means of oppressing God's people. That's one way of deceiving our God, by means of not loving your fellow man or your brothers and sisters. That's deceiving your God, by means of not practicing what is just and what is good. That is deceiving your God. So God, despite of all that, he still considered his other people that followed his instruction of what they must do to remain as his servants. They followed what God expected them. And that is the reason why we continue to help all our brethren who have been oppressed, because we know that is what is the reason why God has set us apart to continue to be true members of the church of Christ. And in doing so, we know what we had to go through. Some were placed in jail. Some were lives were taken away. Some they were rejected and disowned. Some were evicted from their homes. Some were chased, and some even their life was in danger. So many things that we may be able to reflect upon. All of us have our own individual different problems that we had to go through. But in the midst of all that, when we were in the midst of choosing of what to do, we cling to what God wanted. We cling to what our Lord Jesus Christ wanted. Did not our Lord Jesus Christ says you should love your neighbor as you love yourself? And one of the greatest commandment is that we should love our God with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds. If that is the case, then we need to follow what God wants us to do in order to remain as true servants of the Lord Almighty God. So the question is this: what can we expect of God in return if we show him our faithfulness? Let's read here in the book of Psalms, the chapters 18, verse 25 to 26. This is what can be read. 18:25 and then 21 to 24. To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless. For I have kept the ways of the Lord. I am not guilty of turning from my God. All his laws are before me. I have not turned away from his decrees. I have been blameless before him and have kept myself from sin. The Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands in his sight. What is it that you can expect from the Lord Almighty God? Once you show your loyalty and faithfulness to him in the midst of all that you have to go through in this world, in striving to prove yourself to remain as true servants of God, remember what the Bible says: to the faithful, you show your faithful. To the blameless, you show your blameless. So God is always there beside you. Even those whom we cannot reach out physically, but they are encountering oppressions and persecution, even those who may be in jail until now, God will not forsake them. God will always be with them. How else does the Bible make mention? The Bible makes mention, for I have kept the ways of the Lord. I'm not guilty of turning from my God. Remember, if you're not guilty of turning from your God, you would be able to stand firm and boldly and say, you are God's servant. But if you are amongst those who are united in turning away from God, even if you say you did not turn from God, you're a liar and you cannot be amongst those who would remain as God's people. And that's the reason why we're studying this, so that we could go back all in the track of what God wants us to be. The Bible says, I have been blameless before him and I have kept myself from sin. And so what is it that God will do? He will reward those who live righteously according to the cleanness of their hands in his sight. So our question is this: most of all, what is the reward that God will give on behalf of those who show their loyalty to him? In the midst of this battle that we are going through, this is a spiritual battle. The enemy works so hard, but our God is working hard for our salvation. But what we should do, we should work hand in hand with our God so that we would be able to accomplish what we want. And what is this? 91:14-16. This is recorded. God says, I will save those who love me and will protect those who know me as Lord. When they call to me, I will answer them. When they are in trouble, I will be with them. I will rescue them and honor them. I will reward them with long life. I will save them. So is it worth being loyal and faithful to God? Even if you have to lose everything, your social life, is it enough to say that we have God, even if we lost everything? Well, you will receive his protection. In times of your trouble, when you call to him, he will answer you. Has not God proven that to us? And most of all, he will also rescue us, honor us, and save us. Is that not all the boiling point of all why we wanted to follow our God? It's also to be saved. But we know we go to more of an extent of not only wanting to be saved, but because we love God, we rather follow and obey him. Even if we are physically or emotionally or mentally hurt, for as long as God is our God, for as long as we know that we are amongst those whom we consider as his people, we're no greater than the Lord Jesus Christ, who had to endure sufferings in the cross for our sake. It's now your turn to prove your loyalty to your Savior, to your Lord Jesus Christ, and also to God, who has called us to this calling. Let us not lose strength when we feel that we are discouraged, when we feel that we are encountering so many other problems in life. But let us read the conclusion of this lesson that was made. Brothers and sisters, we should convincingly prove to God that we are his true servants, not only by cherishing our election we have received from him by remaining as members of the Church of Christ, but also by faithfully obeying his will, being clean in all our ways of life, and not deceiving him or turning away from him as long as we live. Let us stand and let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we are grateful to be able to understand the clarity of this lesson and how we could remain as your people. There are so many people in this world who claims to recognize and worship you. You have taught us and you have differentiated those who just make a claim to those who followed and obeyed you, even to the point of persecution and oppression. You have proven your loyalty to those who are loyal to you. You have proven your faithfulness to those who are faithful to you. You have proven your rescue to those who are in need, who have been loyal and faithful to you. Oh, Father in heaven, we will never stop praising you. We are your people. As your people, we recognize you as our God. And we thank you for always providing in terms of our need. Please show unto us all the things that we should do. And we feel that we are among those who have been deprived or been among those who have been persecuted and disowned. And all these things could happen to us as long as you don't disown us, as long as we belong to you. That's what's most important. Because when judgment day comes, after all this hard work that we have gone through, we will give it the final rest in the promised land that you promised to your people. Help us when we are heavenly laden. Help us when we are about to fall and collapse. Help us when we have no one to rely on. You are our strength. You are our happiness. You are our joy. You are our inspiration. Don't go away from us. Stick by your side, come what may, that we will not be lost, that we will not be led astray. Oh Lord Jesus, help us to have your characteristic to be our God, even in times of persecution, even in a time when you were being hated and being nailed on the cross for the sake of our salvation. Help us remember whatever we are all going through. If some are in jail, some are disowned, some are cast away, some are still being hunted down or hunted down, whatever the situation, we do this for you because you love us and we're willing to suffer for your church. And that is our happiness. It's because on the day of judgment, on your return, we know that you will not forsake us. We pray for the institution, for those who administer it. May you please bless Brother Eduardo Vimanalo and all those under him. May they have this kind of heart, this lesson that was made by them when Brother Eranio G. Manalo was still alive. May they have the heart to reflect upon this lesson so that they would be able to fix the problems, and all will have the opportunity to remain as your people, and most assuredly, salvation on the day of judgment. Father, we ask everything once again in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Grace and salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of us now and forever. Amen.